Morning, party people. Sherry will be with us in just a minute. She is eating a trucker's breakfast over there. So, which is for her, that's like 3 eggs, 4 pancakes,
hey,
an omelet, and 3 cups of coffee.
No, for the record, I'm having my 2nd cup of decaf. And that's it. All I've consumed today. Well, I almost was like, where's my phone? But there it is. Hello, say good morning.
Good morning. Oh, you met them.
Yeah, so that we know who's here. Hi, Carol. Good morning. Good to see you, sister.
Sista.
So we missed last week.
S-I-S-T-A.
We were busy.
Should that be pointed that direction a little bit? It's pointed down an awful lot. Can it be like pointed up a little? They don't need to see them on the phone.
Okay, I like that it's down because...
Okay, that's good. I just wondering. All good. Whatever you think.
Okay.
Whatevs.
So we missed last week. We were busy. Missed you guys. I really do look forward to this all week. How about you?
Yep, I do.
Yeah, it's fun. It's always fun to see what God's going to do. And we learn as we go right along with you, which I love. And I feel like we have fellowship, even though we don't have a lot of that in real life right now. I feel like this is really good fellowship. Randy's cramming the chapter in.
Actually, it's related to this, but it's not the chapter. But I am reading about stuff we're doing.
Yeah, we actually studied this a few days ago together, so super exciting. Ooh, in my Bible, it's entitled Perilous Times and Perilous Men. Dun, dun, dun. All right, Rainey's going to pray, I think. Hi, Philip. Rainy UK. It's Rainy here as well. Good to see you, brother. Grace, good morning.
Philip's motto is, Philip, your day with Philip. All right.
So if there's any new people here, morning, Grace. And whoop, whoop, Grace just joined my team yesterday.
Super, yeah, Grace. Super way to exciting. Go, Grace.
Congrats and welcome. So exciting. Okay. So, what was I going to say?
No idea. You're the one doing this.
Oh, if anybody's here for the first time, this is Randy. You know who I am because my name is on the video. Sherry Oler. Ryan, good to see you. I'm good. Ryan is the guy that we met in Marseille, France on mission that we ended up spending mission
nice,
with.
Nice, that's awesome.
Yeah, he's fantastic. Fill your cup, Lord. Yeah, all right, let's...
Okay, let's pray.
Let's pray.
Okay, Father, I thank you very much for the opportunity to get to know you more. Lord, we're here for one purpose, and that's to know you more, to hear your voice, to know what you're saying to us in this day and time. Mm. We come together as a group of people, Lord, just wanting to know your heart and wanting to reestablish your sovereignty and your lordship, and just, Lord, draw us closer to you and make us more prepared for the day that you establish your kingdom, Lord Jesus. I just worship you, Lord, and want more of you, and pray that, Father, you would just take away all of the things that are of Sherry and I today, that are of our opinions, that are our false beliefs or whatever, Lord, and make it about your word, only your word, Lord. Just speak through us, speak directly into the hearts of us and those watching and participating. And Lord, just be glorified in everything that we say and do. In the holy name of Jesus, amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen and amen. Amen.
Okie dokie. So we are in 2 Timothy, chapter 4. That's something.
No, 3.
No, 4.
What?
I
perilous times
you.
And perilous men. We didn't do that.
Yes, we did.
Guys, did we do that?
Janice and Jambres. Remember Janice and Jambres? We definitely did. She read the wrong chapter. Just so you guys know, she's not prepared this week.
A minute.
Come back into the screen. You're always on the screen. We absolutely did. And we also talked about how it ended in an odd place in for 4, but we stopped there.
Okay, so I titled this 3, and I've been talking about 3 since yesterday. So, sorry, guys.
All right, you guys. It's really a good thing that I read the Bible and pray.
Stop it. Wait a minute.
But we're in four. I promise you we're in four.
You and I discussed it, but no, we didn't live.
Avoid these people, for among them are those who slip into households and deceive right. weak women.
You and I discussed this on like Tuesday, but we've not discussed this live. You guys, can I get a witness? What is the last chapter we did together two Saturdays ago?
Carol, help us out here. We did three. I know for a fact we did three.
No, he and I did it a couple days ago.
No, we didn't. We didn't do anything this week.
We did.
Baby, you're off this week. It is.
He's so wrong.
You're on the wrong week. Someone help us out here. This is embarrassing.
No, okay. So let me just take you back. So we were having some issues with a person, and we were both very frustrated. And you were like, you know what? We just need to pray. And then you were like, I think we need to read the Bible or something.
Where are they at here? Okay, someone's laughing at us, not with us. I can tell those are laughing at us, not with us. All right, hold on a second.
Okay, put a 1 in the comments if you vote for Sherry's right. Put a 2 in the comments if you think Randy's right.
It's probably
right.
The Lord telling us we need to do chapter 3 again.
He's so wrong. We did not discuss chapter 3. Carol stumped. She's got the little, thinking face.
All right, give us 30 seconds, because I'm remembering now half of what she's saying.
Uh-huh.
Would you please stay in the screen? Because I think they want to see.
I don't understand. I am in the screen.
This is what you do.
You know, this is how we always handle conflict.
This is what you do. Like, this is Sherry. Then she looks up.
Through laughing.
I'm in the screen.
Through laughing and...
This is her. And so, people,
punching.
Here's what we're doing.
Stop
I'm in the screen. What's the problem?
Oh, my gosh. We're losing. The watchers are dropping like flies.
No, I think they're about...
Dropping like flies. That's the saying.
That's the
right?
saying, yeah.
Okay.
All right.
About to bake the cookie. Carol's going to go back up and look at our last video.
Thanks, Carol. I'll give you $10 if you say we're on number 4.
No. My friends don't lie.
I know, but she might be intimidated. That's the problem. She might be bullied. All right, we'll start in 3 just because I know it'll be a rough weekend if I don't. Oh, Philip, come on, man. All right, I'm with you. That's right. Philip knows it's 4. He just doesn't want to say anything. All right, we're going to go ahead and do...
Okay, God bless your day, Philip.
That's right, Carol. Don't worry about it, Carol. We're going to go into 3 here.
And he's going to get revelation as we read about the whole, which chapter we're supposed to be on. That's what's going to happen.
Carol said burb.
Be right back.
I know what it meant. I was joking.
On the Facebook and the cool people, we do things like that.
Philip didn't go anywhere. You misunderstood his message. He said he's still listening.
Oh, he's listening. Okay, good.
All right, Philip. Here we go, dude. All right, so we're going to get into 3 because if I don't do 3, it's going to be a rough weekend for me. So, hey, Debbie.
Debbie missed all the fun. Good morning, sister.
Philip's still driving. Be careful, Philip, please.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing.
Don't get in an accident here.
Yeah, be safe.
All right, here we go. 2 Timothy 3. Sorry for that giant introduction here. We promise we'll do better going forward here. But understand this, that in the last days, hard times will come, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, hard-hearted, unforgiving, backbiting, without self-control, brutal, hating what is good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to an outward form of godliness but denying its power.
Can I read it here? Because there's a couple of different words that I like better. So check after this to settle the debate. There is no debate in my opinion. Okay. But know this, in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors. So I read that one last night, actually, again, and the word treacherous, it was good, obviously, but traitors is like, oh, that makes way more sense in this list, traitors. Headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power.
Yep.
Do you want to stop there or do you want to keep reading?
No, I want to do it a little bit more. Avoid these godless people, for among these are those who slip into households and deceive weak women, weighed down with sins, led away by various desires, always learning yet never able to come to the knowledge of truth. We can probably stop there.
Okay.
Why did we read this in terms of What I do remember us reading it in terms of like that issue, but why? Why did we pick this? Just because we were at next
minute? Yeah, because okay. We were just like, okay, you know what? Let's just drop everything and do our Bible study because we were both a little frustrated.
Yeah. Not with one another. We were frustrated with a person we're dealing with in the real world. Because marriage is not the real world. All right. So it's pretty fascinating. I think, we could go down a couple different paths here, right? But I think it's abundantly clear that we're supposed to be witnesses to all those around us, but yet here it's really clear that we're supposed to avoid these people. Mm-hmm. So there's I always get bothered when people say like, we have to have a balancing act, or there's something to intimate that there's compromise.
Right.
In our position of faith, there's no compromise. Jesus never compromised, but there is a bit of a balancing act that we have to play, because most of us were in the secular world. We work in the secular world. We abide in it, and we want to witness to those around us, but, we are to avoid these people like the plague. And I think it's fair to say, and for the record, this isn't our first time reading it. We really did study this in relation to a personal issue we were having with someone. I thought that we did it in this Bible study. I have to grudgingly admit on camera that I think Sherry's correct. But I do remember us studying it for this person. And the problem was, remember now, the context of all of this is that Paul, and it'll say in the end here, Paul knows he's about to die. So it indicates that in chapter 4, Paul knows he's about to be martyred, which is also interesting in and of itself, because we won't go too far, but Paul says he's, that Christ will save him, Christ will deliver him, but yet he also knows he's about to be martyred, which is interesting. But anyway, Paul is downloading, has both in 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, he's preparing Timothy, to take on his mantle of leadership for the New Testament church. Think about how big a deal that is. So Paul is downloading to Timothy and saying, look, you're taking over the mantle of leadership. You're the one that's leading the church. And especially in 1 Timothy, he leads him through how to lead the church. And Paul doesn't do it in compromising terms. It's very, very clear. Here's the people that are part of the church. Here's the people that aren't part of the church. And so I think here, he's being very, very clear about those with whom we're in fellowship with, which is a big difference. Mm. Those with whom we are intimate with, close with, those who we share the faith with. And it isn't our job to love. Let me back up a second. So also in 1 Timothy, we're in 2 Timothy, but in 1 Timothy...
Stephanie's asking what chapter and verse.
Oh, I'm sorry. Stephanie, we are in 2 Timothy chapter 3. In 1 Timothy especially, then partly in the second, Paul's primary theme is false teaching. We really have to understand just how vital that is. So in a couple of books in which Paul is telling Timothy, here's how to lead Christ's church, the number one thing he says is root out false teaching, right? And so what he's saying here is avoid these kind of people like the plague, because they are essentially false teachers. In 1 Timothy, he calls it, he says their teaching is the doctrine of demons. Mm-hmm. And so it's not our jobs to try to debate false teachers into the kingdom, or to try to like share in hers, mine was treacherous, hers was traitors. We don't get into fellowship with people that are anti-God. That's what they are. They're anti-Messiahs, if you will.
Right.
And so I think that's the difference for me. Like, I work in a place where in my circle of maybe 10 or so people that I work closely with, none of them are believers. I pray for them daily. I try as best I can to share, I don't want to say I share the gospel, but I do share my faith, that my life is changed by my faith. But they're not in a position of intimacy with me. They're not in a position where they affect my faith in the Lord. And so the people that I learn from, the people that I listen to their instruction, like share, or their correction, are people that are absolutely godly people. Mm-hmm. And anybody that doesn't point you towards Christ, you're supposed to avoid.
Mm-hmm. I would just want to say good morning to a couple of people. Good morning, Rich. I hope you're really here. Give those babies a hug for us. And good morning, Stephanie and Carolina. Okay, so yeah, so years ago, I remember just some old friends of ours stating, it was very simple, but it was kind of this aha moment for me. Like, the church is not for the sinner. And you're like, what? That's the opposite of what we've been told. But their belief was that believers are to come together and seek the Lord in worship and in fellowship and in prayer and in Bible study. And then we are to go out into the world and love the world and cast out demons, heal the sick, raise the dead. And then again, when we come back together, it's the body of Christ, the true believers that have left their old life behind and are fully picking up their cross daily and dying to self to follow him. And if we bring the sinner into that communion, that's the yeast. If we bring the sinner into our fellowship, that's the yeast. In the American church and probably other places in the world, the model is totally different. The model is bring everybody in and let them, you know, work out their salvation as they go. And I'm sure you guys have seen it, as we've seen it, that people get saved. You know, they may come to church, somebody invites them to church, and then there's a gospel message, and so they get saved and they go to the altar, maybe they even get baptized. But 10, 15 years later, they're the same person. They're still struggling with pornography. They're still having problems in their marriage. Their health is still completely failing. And they can't get over bad habits or addictions. They're the same. Nothing's changed. And you could say, well, that's a bad church. Well, no, it's not really maybe a bad church. Maybe they're doing everything right. But the problem is the yeast has been invited in. And so to Randy's point, Paul is saying we're not to have anything to do with these people when it comes to our fellowship in the Lord, when it comes to evangelism and loving them and feeding them and giving them water and taking the coat off our back and those kind of things, 100%. But they don't get to come into the body and corrupt it.
Yeah, this is a short chapter, so I think I have time for some examples. So I personally look around, like, everything in my life is like an example or analogy, like how can I quantify it in terms of what we're looking around today? And so I think this list is really harsh. Like, it's blasphemers, hard-hearted, unforgiving. But I think in our day and age, we tend to forget what this can look like in our world. So in other words, most of us would say, look, we don't have these people in our lives. This is no big deal for me because I'm not close or intimate or in community with these kind of people. But what could it look like for us today? Well, I'll give just a couple of quick examples. There's a pastor that I've never mentioned his name, but I talk about him a lot. And I think he's got a huge church. They have a college with it, a prominent seminary, if you will, with the church. And so I've wanted to believe he's got a study Bible. I've wanted to believe, if you can't figure out who it is yet, you might eventually, but I've wanted to believe that because of his intellect, the study Bible, the seminary, that what he has to say is biblical. And I want to, if the Lord is teaching me something, I want to humble myself and listen to what he has to say. But I cannot get past the fact that this particular person is so mean and arrogant. He's mean-spirited and he's abundantly arrogant. And so what, in my own guilt, in my own, I think it's the enemy trying to say, well, that's just you, you're being judgmental, this guy. No, it's actually some of the things we read here. Arrogant is one of them, boastful is another. So that's one example of how we should just avoid those people like the plague. The other one is another very, very prominent pastor. He's at the other end of the spectrum where he's like a love everybody into the kingdom. And I don't mean that disrespectfully. We are supposed to love everybody, but I just mean he doesn't condemn sin. He doesn't condemn, like Cher said, unrighteousness. He made a claim in 2018 that we should unhitch our faith from the Old Testament. And then he tried to explain it away, but it was abundantly clear that everything he said was utter and complete false teaching. And he said, and what he said very clearly, made no bones about it, was that many people seeking the Lord will be turned off by many of the passages, the harsh passages of God's judgment in the Old Testament. Well, please understand, in the New Testament, which is what he said, we should be only studying the New Testament. And this is a huge pastor with a massive amount of literature. Well, literature that goes out to teach churches. So he's teaching other churches.
Right.
The New Testament, Jesus said, you're to take up your cross and follow me. When the rich young man came to Jesus, and he was righteous, he was seeking God. And he said to Jesus, what must I do to enter kingdom? And Jesus said, sell everything you have and come follow me. Jesus didn't water down his message. Jesus didn't try to win people into the kingdom by telling them the good things. Jesus did the opposite. He said, look, this is how, when people came to Jesus and said, I want to follow you, he made that bizarre statement that foxes have dens and, but the Son of Man has nowhere to rest his head. I forget how it goes. Mm-hmm. He made it abundantly clear how hard the Christian life is.
Right.
My point is this. There's a scholar out of England that I think he's right with the Lord. I'm fairly certain. He made a statement. He said, when you combine a half truth with a whole truth, you end up with a complete lie. Mm-hmm. You can't combine a partial truth and that's what these pastors, that's what these leaders are doing. There's one that I've railed against before. I'm going to do it again. Her name is Jen Hatmaker. And I'll tell you this, because she is leading hundreds of thousands of women away from the Lord by saying, you need to seek first your happiness, your true self. And she does it through and through by saying overtly that she is a disciple of Jesus Christ. Well, let me tell you something. It would take you 30 seconds to figure out that her beliefs of the Bible are false. Mm-hmm. And so what I'm saying is, where this list may seem overly harsh, this is, I'm kind of coming back to it, it's a lot, but where this list may seem harsh, and we may have a tendency, I have a tendency to read it and go, gosh, I don't know any of those people in my life that are this harsh. Well, they're all around us, and they're all around us in the form of false teachers, mm-hmm. right? They're all around us in those that say they love the Lord, but yet they're lovers of money, right?
Or lovers of pleasure.
Yeah, they say they love the Lord, but they're arrogant. And look, I'm not judging everybody else. I'm saying I got to warn myself against these things. I have to read this list and go, Lord, where am I going down that path? Lord, where have I been arrogant? Lord, where have I put money ahead of you? So I'm not trying to just say this against other people. I'm just simply saying, let's not pass over this part of Scripture, think that it doesn't apply to us, right. And realize that that these people are absolutely all around us, and predominantly they're in the church. Last thing I'll mention is, I saw a quote, and I can't for the life of me, I'd say it if I could remember, but I can't remember the context of the quote. But it talked about one of these other Hillsong pastors that have fallen into sexual sin yet again. Mm-hmm. And the person, it was a secular, non-Christian person, said, why is it, this is their quote, why is it that when Christians become something like more Christian or more like God, or when they claim to be more of a Christian, they look less like God. They look, and I thought, wow, that's a non-Christian saying that. We should be fleeing from people and avoiding them like the plague that have, you know, traits that indicate that they're not truly of the Lord. That was probably a terrible dissertation, but I just felt like it was not.
No, that's great. And, you know, part of the problem with Jen, and this is huge. I remember very early on, she was a Christian author. She really was a Christ-following author by all appearances. And she was gaining popularity. Then all of a sudden, and I'm sure if you were in her inner circle, it wasn't all of a sudden. But publicly, all of a sudden, what she did is she said, in this big grandiose announcement with, you know, beautiful pictures of herself, because she is very pretty and their family is very, you know, it looks, by all appearances, everything looks right. And so it was this big announcement, picture with her and her husband, of how they had been fasting and praying for 15 months or 12 months or something, fasting and praying and seeking the Lord through his word and through other people that love him. And they've come to the conclusion that
homosexuality is totally fine. It's not a sin and we've misinterpreted. Well, the problem is that all these people that have been following her and liking her truth, as soon as she says, we've studied the word for 12
She said they got it in the original language. She said they went to the original text.
Right. And that's one of the lies, is that the original text is only talking about pedophilia when it says homosexuality. And that's just, that's a blank lie. But my point is that just because somebody says, I've fasted, I've prayed, I've sought the Lord, and I read his word, it doesn't absolve them. And I remember thinking at the time, feeling like, well, I've never fasted and prayed on any one thing for 12 months, so she must be right. Like, I almost feel like the Lord allowed me to consciously follow the path of my brain so that I could see what happened in that statement and stop it. Does that make sense? And so it's interesting, and I can't find it right now, but in Romans 1, it talks about how they worshiped man instead of the creator. They were, do you know where it is?
They created things instead of the creator.
Yeah. Okay, so that to me, when it says lovers of themselves, that doesn't necessarily mean arrogance. Pride, proud or arrogant is listed in a different word. So to me, when it says lovers of themselves, this is a different thing. I don't think it's being redundant. And I think lovers of themselves points back to that Roman scripture, and it just means deciding that we know best, deciding that humans know better than God, that you know, like Randy always talks about, this intellectualism that decides that we're so intellectual that we can figure out what God really meant, and that he couldn't have possibly meant this because it feels bad, you know, or because it's going to hurt somebody's feelings. So then therefore we're going to intellectualize it away, which is exactly what Jen did. So when it says, I think that the fact that it says lovers of themselves first is huge. It means creating their own God, trying to create a God that is going to allow them to do whatever it is they want. And then it lists all the things they want. They want to be unholy. They want to follow pleasure. They want to love money. They want to despise what is good. You know, it is the ultimate idolatry. You're choosing to worship what you want and who you want God to be rather than the God of the Bible. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, let's see what Danny said. We must be examining the fruit of our lives. Yeah, the fruit. And the fruit of those who we learn from. Thank you for giving real world examples. Oh, amen, sister. Yeah, that is for sure. That's what Jesus said.
Yeah, let me read 8 and 9 because then there's another. We'll just finish up that example. So 8 and 9. So again, for those, maybe I didn't say it, it's 2 Timothy 3. And now I'm in 8. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so do these people oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and worthless concerning the faith. But these people will not make any more progress, for their folly, like that of Jannes and Jambres, will be obvious to everyone. And I think to Danny's point, you've got to truly examine all of their fruit. I just want to mention this one example again really quick because I caught it this morning, actually. That's what I was on my phone reading, trying to cram, because I just caught it. This English scholar. Now, I really rail against false intellectualism a lot. Intellectualism in our day and age is an excuse to not believe the Bible.
Right.
All that it is. False intellectualism is saying that I'm smarter, I know more than what the Bible explicitly states, which is, it's such an arrogance in God's eyes. Mm-hmm. It's such a slap in his face. The creator of all of it, of eternity, that made the intricacies of our bodies and all of creation, to think that we can explain away his word because we know it better, is such an arrogance in God's eyes.
Right.
But having said that, there is a theologian out of England that of everything I've read and listened to of his, I just think he has a heart for the Lord. And this is what I want to say. The other person, the second person in America, the pastor I mentioned that has the study Bible, and that he, by all appearances, he's right as well. But here's the problem. So the English guy that I think loves the Lord wrote a book that his mind is just on a different level of mine. He's just, his intellect is beyond what I can understand. And he wrote a book along those lines. The Lord has clearly gifted him, and he just loves the Lord. When you read and when you listen to him, his heart is humble. He never talks to you without taking you to the love and salvation of Jesus Christ. He also never talks without saying that we are sinners and we're only saved through the salvation of Jesus Christ. So he makes that abundantly clear. This other pastor in America has a video out. He did a sermon where he just really ripped this guy to shreds and ripped his book. And he did it in a way that was mean-spirited. It was arrogant. It just came across as rubbing, just going after him personally. Now, he's got a huge church, huge school, and people take what he says verbatim. I have a tendency to listen to that guy and think, gosh, what's he saying? That because he's got this school. He wrote a study Bible. He clearly knows it better than me. And I want to be humble and listen to what he has to say. But then I come back to basically the basics of the word that says, on the one hand, we've got a guy that has just a love for Jesus, wants to lead people to Jesus, and doesn't shortchange the gospel. He says we're sinners and we can only be saved through Jesus. On the other side, we've got a person that just is arrogant and mean-spirited. Mm-hmm. And so what I have to force myself to do, and this may seem like people accuse us, the world accuses us of being deniers of science or book burners. Right. It's not the case. The fact is, I have to shut down that other person because clearly, sorry guys, we have a dog that's wants to kill delivery people. Simba, come on, buddy. Anyway, the point is, like, for me, the real world example is that. It's like, okay, as much as I think this guy should be right because he wrote a study Bible and he has a seminary, time and time and time again, I mean, all the time, what he does is just rip on people personally and essentially call them stupid and blind and say that they're all going to hell.
I think it's time that we tell them who we're talking about, because we bring them up often enough, and well, it is dangerous. And so
it's John MacArthur. And I'm always afraid of offending people only because I don't come at this like I know people so exceptionally well that I know John MacArthur's heart, or if some of you out there are devout Christ followers. I had a friend that I did jail ministry with, and he would always quote John MacArthur every single time we were in jail, and I never said anything to him personally because I knew his heart for the Lord. Mm. But for me, as I watch John MacArthur, there is just such an intense pride and arrogance, and he just rips on people personally. He did it with Beth Moore. He destroyed Beth Moore instead of just saying, look, here are the spiritual things that someone might have wrong, or here's what the word of the Lord says. And so to point people back to the word, and instead of what he does is he points people away from another. And I understand there's meaning in that. Like, if you have a false teacher out there, you might want to say to your friend, hey, that's a false teacher. Get the heck away from them. But I think more often than not, what we want to do is what we're doing today, and what you guys are doing, point people to the word. What does God say? Does that make sense at all?
Like, it does. What's he saying? So he's not necessarily, taking what this other person said and saying, here's how it differs from scripture. He's just ripping him. He's this, he's that, what the heck's he even talking about? He doesn't. So he's just complaining about him. And there is a difference. But let's just go into John MacArthur a little bit. We've talked around him enough, and I don't think this is an accident, but I was in, I'm in a Christian, it's called Christian Women Support Group. It's terrible. There's 40,000 women in it. Probably the person that started it did it immediately when Facebook got started. And so literally the best name for a group ever, Christian Women Support Group. And so every Christ-following woman and everyone that calls herself that rushed to this group. Well, now there's in this group of 40,000 people, women, there's Christian witches, literally Christian witches. There's
which we know that you can't be that, for the record. She's saying what they call themselves.
Right. I was quoting. You missed my little. So there's Christian witches, so to speak. There's just all sorts. There's lots and lots of Catholics. There's Jesus is mentioned more than Muhammad in the Quran, and they respect Jesus. I met a Muslim 2 days ago at a park and got to talk about Jesus a little bit with his family, him and his family. And they believe in there. They get excited. You ask them, hey, Jesus is mentioned in your Quran. They get really excited about it. So anyway, my point being is that anybody that uses the name of Jesus considers themselves a Christian. That's not the definition of a Christ follower according to the word. In this group, lots of times these young women will come and say, I just accepted Christ. Where should I start reading my Bible? And I stay in this group because the advice is so terrible that I always want to catch as many as the Lord will let me and send them back to the truth. And so anyway, lots of these people say, read John MacArthur, get the John MacArthur Study Bible, look up John MacArthur, John MacArthur. And I'm always like, cringe, no. Let's talk about John MacArthur very briefly, even a deeper level than Randy has talked about. I would call John MacArthur a false teacher, and I don't say that lightly. And if you guys know me, you know I don't say that lightly. If you look behind the curtain into his youth camp, there's tons of Illuminati symbolism, tons of it. The names, the symbols that they use. You've got to peek behind the curtain and see. And just know that in these end times, Satan has set up very, very prominent pastors and very prominent churches in order to give a tiny bit of truth so that in the end times, you've been eating their truth for so long, now you trust them. And so then when they start to venture towards the Antichrist, you don't detect it. It's like the boiling frog. And I would put John MacArthur in that category. I'm done.
Okay. Yeah, and I just want you guys to know, my intent isn't to rip on people personally. I just, John MacArthur is someone that I have struggled with for a really long time because I've read his stuff, I've listened to him a ton, and it just didn't sit well in my spirit. And that's all. To me, it's a pertinent example. That's why I wanted to bring it up. But let's keep going here, babe.
Well, wait, I do want to talk about who Jan and Jambres are because we stopped and had to look that up when we were studying, and so we should mention that. They are the magicians. When God sent Moses to Pharaoh to let my people go, the magicians, the sorcerers that came out and copied, and this is huge, they copied what God was doing through Moses with their enchantments. It was smoke and mirrors. God was doing it through Moses. They were doing it through Satan. And I don't think that we should overlook that. This is what he's saying, that there are going to be people that are copying godliness, but they're actually doing it by Satan, for Satan, with Satan. They're coming against what God is doing, but it will appear to be the same, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Now it does say though, like Cher said, that their work will become obvious to anyone. So then we'll pick up in 10, because how do we stay on the right path? How are we not fooled by a Jannes and Jambres? Mm-hmm. How are we not fooled by false teachers? And he goes into that in 10. You, however, closely followed my teaching, manner of life, purpose, faithfulness, patience, love, perseverance, as well as persecutions and sufferings that happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and the Lord rescued me from them all. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Messiah Yeshua will be persecuted, but evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. So I think part of it is right there. Remain in complete faithfulness to the Lord. It's okay to, like this case, Timothy followed the teaching that he learned in Paul. It's absolutely okay. We're to guard heavily against false teachers, but we're to follow the pattern that has been put before us of those who clearly are not false teachers, but you need to discern who those people are. You need to look at their entire life. Did they endure persecutions? Did they embrace persecutions? Some people could say, well, John MacArthur stood against the closing of the church in California. Look, there was no persecution there. That was, I don't want to go down that path.
Controlled opposition.
Yeah, it was, anyway. I do think we can't gloss over the fact that it says that all who desire to live a godly life in Messiah Yeshua will be persecuted. I don't know what that's going to look like. Is that going to look like what it looks like in foreign countries? It seems to be going that way. But I do know this. in our day and age, what we have to, in my opinion, what the very least that this means is that we have to view our lives as completely temporary. Other parts of scripture, Paul says that we're travelers, sojourners on this earth, and that we are not to view ourselves as permanent residents here on earth. And so the way to do that is to understand that anything can be taken at any point in time, and that it's okay because we live for an eternity with Jesus Christ. I don't know what persecutions are going to come. I don't know what they're going to come for Cher or for me. As I sit here and do this thing here, her discussion about homosexuality goes through me because I live in a workplace, or I work in a place that wouldn't sit too well with. But you know what? The Lord, I've got to be faithful to the Lord first and foremost, right? And He's going to take care of me ultimately. The point, though, is that I just have to view everything here on earth as completely temporary and falling away, and I'm working for an eternal kingdom.
Yeah.
Right? We can debate persecutions all day long, but that's in the very least what we should do. And when we test other people and we test their teachings, that's one of the tests. Did these people give up, maybe not literally, maybe they didn't move to Africa to be a missionary, maybe they did, but did they at least in some way, shape, or form, were they people that gave up their lives on earth for an eternal kingdom? I think that's the ultimate test, especially with our prosperity gospel. A lot of Christian pastors and Christians have distanced themselves. I think this is important. They've distanced themselves from the terminology prosperity gospel largely because of how the prosperity preachers have been attacked. Mm-hmm. But make no mistake about it, they're still prosperity pastors. They're still prosperity teachers. Look at their churches, look at their homes, look at their cars. And I'm not saying just about that. I have to be the same person. I have to be the same person that doesn't gather up those things for myself, right? But that's what our churches look like. That's what our pastors look like. And so we have to be careful that we're not people that are trying to build up things here on earth, but that we're building up things in the kingdom, right?
Yeah, and money is such a very tricky topic, because I do believe that the Lord blesses and blesses and blesses and blesses. We look at the talents, you know, it was about money. We can apply it to talents, but talents were money. And so He does bless, and He does double, and He does triple, and He does increase. But for just a great example of, I think, of a godly way to handle riches, I think Dani Johnson's story is amazing. She was homeless and now has millions. And the Lord convicted her in her big house, and she sold everything and got a nice house, but very small, and 80 or 90% of her income goes to the kingdom, and then she lives on the 10%. But real quick, and it's Dani, if you want to look her up, Dani Johnson, she's great. really quick, I just want to, my verse 12 says, yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. I know a lot of Christians that take off that word persecution and say that all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer. And Satan uses that to make them sick. And then they accept their diseases and they accept their sickness and say, oh, I'm suffering for the Lord. That's not what scripture says. So I just have to throw that out there. That's my thing. That's a lie. The Lord does not want you sick.
Amen. Okay. I feel like I'm off today. Like, I feel like I'm rambling. So I apologize if I am.
No, he's not.
I feel but like I'm just kind of all over the place.
Danny left a comment, or somebody did. Let me see. So I want to go
Don't forget, Phil's driving, so we don't want to be too distracting on visual.
Okay, Jenna, there you go. I feel that many popular pastors and evangelists with huge churches start out seeking God and leading people to Christ, and then they end up getting a big head as their church grows and falling off God's path. Yeah, they begin to see lots of money. Yeah, well, and that goes right back to, thank you, Jenna, that goes right back to the fact that they're letting yeast in, right? They're inviting the world to come hang out in the church with the fellowship of believers. And Jesus said it, a little yeast will leaven the whole lump.
So, well, and I want you guys to know something. I think that's important. Thank you for the comment. I think here's what's important for me personally. As I say these things, I don't say them, this is true. I don't even say them as much against the people I'm talking about, like the John MacArthurs. I'm literally worried about myself. I think, okay, am I becoming arrogant? Am I becoming prideful? How attached am I to money? How attached am I to the comfort of this world? How fearful am I getting in this world when the Lord called me away from all fear? And I mean that very genuinely to you guys. Like, if I come across like I'm railing against other people, I want you to know that for me, I have a deep, deep fear of going the wrong way, of not being told that I was a good and faithful servant. The parable of the talent scares the crap out of me, because the third person was given one talent and Jesus didn't say, hey, you screwed this up. Jesus said, get away from me, you wicked and lazy servant. That scares the crap out of me. And now I've been in so many men's Bible studies over the years for years in which you would say that to people and they'd say, oh, don't worry, you're covered in God's grace. No, I am worried. He told that servant, get away from me, you wicked and lazy servant. And you can try to intellectualize that away from me all day long, but you're not Jesus Christ and you're not the one that's going to judge me. And so I just want you guys to know that, like, if this sounds like I'm railing against these people, please know that people have to be diligent about guarding their own hearts and minds and mm-hmm. not follow people. And your comment, whoever that was, I'm sorry, who was that? Jenna was perfect, because they're just, we have such a loyalty in America to pastors, to people, mm-hmm. and they will blindly turn away from scripture rather to defend someone who's clearly in the wrong. You know, you would never do that with your child. If you had a child, you would never say to them, hey, it's okay to run in the street naked if you want to, because I love you. Of course not. You'd say, get inside, dingbat, because one, you're naked, and two, you're going to kill yourself. The point is, we say those things. We say those harsh things, and we guard against things that we know to be wrong, and yet we're not really willing to do that in American churches. And that just is crazy to me. And scripture says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Mm-hmm. And I personally don't ever want to lose the fear of the Lord. This is a big rabbit hole I went down. Huge. I apologize. This isn't in 2 Timothy 3. But I pray personally that for Cher, for myself, for our family, that we just don't lose the fear of the Lord. Because I feel like even when I'm being an idiot, even when I'm in sin, and like, we want these happy, lovey feelings. That the entire platform of Gen Hatmaker is wonderful, lovey-dovey feelings, right? Where's the fear of the Lord? Right. The fact of the matter is, loving feelings aren't going to cause me to be a good husband. What is the fear of the Lord. That's probably the best way I could put it. Sometimes Cher and I are in an amazing place, and I take care of her just because we're in that great place. Other times, I need to be a good husband because I fear the Lord, because I don't feel like being one to her. It's sin either way if I'm not, but it's the fear of the Lord that will cause me to be a good husband even when I don't want to be, right? Mm-hmm. If I follow the platform of the Gen Hatmaker, I treat people how they treat me.
Right.
And if they're not nice to me, screw them.
Well, and a lot of those teachers, and she one of them, I can't remember, but a lot of those style teachers, the Gen Hatmakers and others that are going that direction where it's love, 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 Jesus would just love, there, a lot of them are getting divorced, and it is that she is one getting divorced or did get divorced. So it's that they're following their feelings. They're following their heart, right? That's the way of the world. Follow your heart. They say it in every movie.
Well, the biggest one now is,
the opposite.
I'm sorry, baby. The biggest one now is love yourself. Love yourself. Take care of yourself first.
Yeah.
Jesus said he's literally the exact opposite.
Right.
Like, you're supposed to put yourself last. Those who want to be first in my kingdom will be last.
And the heart is wicked. Scripture says the heart is wicked. And so, but real quick, I forget what you said in the beginning, but it's something like, you know, what are you fearing? How much are you giving into fear? Are you giving into fear in the world? And that is, oh my gosh, that is COVID. Everybody is compromising because of fear. Everybody. Not everybody, but you know what I mean? The world is compromising because of the fear of COVID. They're compromising their faith. They're compromising their church. They're compromising their relationships. They're compromising their just everything based on COVID.
All right. Again, I apologize. I feel like I'm like all over the place today, guys. So I apologize for that.
Jesus warns about these people. Amen, brother. Many will come in his name. Thank you for providing the space to dig deep into the Word. Thank you, Danny. Your pastor is an amazing man of God. That's awesome, Philip. Yay. You are invited to Prayer Academy International. He said his pastor is an amazing man of God, and we are invited to Prayer Academy International. Oh, I wish I could do that.
Let's keep going here, though.
Okay. Examine ourselves first. Great teaching today. Loving it. Thanks, guys. Your pastor is like you guys, honest and sincere.
God bless you.
That's awesome.
All right. Well, I feel like I'm all over the place. So I apologize, you guys. I have trouble listening to people that go down too many rabbit holes or like squirrel, but that's me today. So anyway, let's read the rest of this. Picking up in again, 2 Timothy 3:14. You, however, continue in what you've learned and what you have become convinced of, for you know from whom you learned, and that from childhood you've known the sacred writings that are able to make you wise, leading to salvation through trusting in Messiah Yeshua. All scripture is inspired by God and useful for teaching, for reproof, for restoration, and for training in righteousness, so that the person belonging to God may be capable, fully equipped for every good deed. Now, some of you guys are going to roll your eyes, but I'm going to bring up the same two examples for earlier because I think that they're absolutely spot on. One, and please just bear with me here. I know we've already talked about it. Like Cher said, Jen Hatmaker claimed that her husband at the time, who was a pastor, don't forget, they were pastors.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Yes, he was in the position of pastor when they did this. Said that they studied scripture, they went to the original text, and they said it was different than what we learned. Paul clearly says to Timothy here to continue in what you have learned and become convinced of. In other words, don't let people come along and tell you that scripture isn't what you think it is.
Right.
Scripture isn't what it says. They've got some sort of new teaching. Bull crap. Sorry about that. But that's just garbage. The Bible has never changed. It will never change.
Amen.
The second one, and this one points directly to the other example I brought up, is, and the other one, I'll just tell you, was Andy Stanley in 2018 said we need to unhitch our faith from the Old Testament. And he made it a way. Let me tell you something, guys. He said it a way that would trick 90% of the people that heard it. They go, no, that's not what he meant. I guarantee you, everybody who backed Andy Stanley started it with this statement. Oh, that's not what he meant. Oh, it's what he meant. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely what he meant. And he went on to say that we are to only teach people about the love of Jesus and not scare them off by the Old Testament. Well, let me tell you something. If you don't scare them out of hell, that's anti-biblical. But here's what he says to that part here. All scripture is useful for teaching, for reproof, for restoration. Now, understand something. When Paul wrote this, the New Testament did not exist. It wasn't in existence. Mm-hmm. Who was Paul? What was Paul talking about? The Old Testament.
Amen.
That's all he was talking about. Mm-hmm. So Andy Stanley, people that back Andy Stanley, you think that he wasn't really saying that? Then what the heck was he saying? He said, unhitch your faith from the Old Testament. Only tell them about Jesus. He went on to say, and guys, you can Google this. He went on to quote that Peter and Paul and a third one, I don't want to say the third because I can't remember. I don't want to misquote him. He said they did the very same thing, that they unhitched their faith from Jewish tradition. Look.
So crazy.
Paul only had the Old Testament. He said all scripture is useful. He was telling Timothy, go back to the Old Testament. Points to Jesus Christ. All the Old Testament points to the Messiah, who was Jesus Christ. So again, the point here isn't to pick on Andy Stanley. It's guys, we got to listen to what the Word says, and don't let them explain it away by saying that's not what he meant.
Right.
Because what he should have meant in our day and age, here's what's happening. There is so much, and actually, I thought we were in the next one, and I'll just give a hint to the next one, because in chapter 4 it says, they will pile up for themselves teachers in keeping with their own desires to have their ears tickled.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, we get so far down this path in which we justify to people. And we say, well, that's not what they meant. Or no, they're not a bad person. Or look, it's not about them being a bad person. It's not about us judging them. It's about the fact that they are false teachers. They are giving false teachings. And we should not entertain that in our brains and in our hearts. The enemy wants a foothold in our heart. I will tell you, as an early Christian, probably the best thing the Lord did for me, and I'm still so far behind where I should be in my faith, but one of the first things the Lord taught me was the concept that the enemy wanted a foothold in my life. This is a stupid analogy. I don't mean to insult anybody's intelligence, but if I there's such a difference between if my door is locked and if my door is just opened an inch. If my door's open an inch, whoever wants in is going to get in, mm-hmm. period. But if my door's locked, they're not getting in. The enemy wants a foothold into your life. And he's getting that foothold through Andy Stanley. He's getting it through Jen Hatmaker. He's getting it through even John MacArthur. Even now, I still struggle with John MacArthur. Because I hate to call him a false teacher, but he is. The enemy wants a foothold through false teaching and false teachers. And so going back to what we read today in verse 5, avoid these mm-hmm, people. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Avoid them. Now, mm-hmm. understand something. Avoid doesn't mean confront them. Avoid, unless you have to, unless like Sharon hers, where she's purposely teaching people, building up people. I'm not going to go attack them for no reason. I'm not going to go engage them for no reason. Mm-hmm. In my own teaching and fellowship, I just, the word says to avoid them.
Yeah, mine says turn away. Literally turn the other direction. There was something you just said that I wanted to get back to real quick. I don't think I remember. You can keep going.
That's
No, I do. I do know. I want to, two things. When it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God, you know, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. And you talked about the Old Testament. There's the scripture, and I don't remember what it is, but it's one of my favorites, and it's follow the ancient paths. Follow the ancient paths. I think it says, and you will find rest for your soul or something. Jesus is the Old Testament. From the first letter of the Old Testament, it starts to point to Jesus. He was there. He was writing it. He is the living word, the whole word. So when Andy Stanley says, unhitch yourself from the Old Testament, he's saying, leave Jesus behind. And then he's saying, only look to Jesus. He means the Jesus that he created by only concentrating on the parts of the New Testament that he likes. I'll read that comment, and then I don't think we've done this yet, and I think it's to our, I don't know what the word is, but we need to share the gospel. Okay. Actually, like, if there's anybody ever watching this that is like, well, this is all great, this sounds great, I want to be on that narrow path following the true Jesus, how do I do that, you know? How do I get saved today? Let's see, love this teaching. So there's a big difference between the fear of the Lord versus fear of those who are in political power. Yeah, amen to that, sister. Even when God okie-dokied those who are in political positions, right? Well, I don't think God gets involved in politics at all. Jesus did not. And so we could go down that Trump path, but you know how I feel, Kathleen.
I think probably saying the same thing, just in different wording.
Yeah, and then Debbie, it's not easy when they have taught us the truth for so long. It's heartbreaking.
It is. Right. And that's the hardest part, man. You're spot on. Like Cher said, these people started on a path. And look, maybe I say this too much, and I apologize if I do, but I don't want to be that guy. I do a ton of YouTube watching, which I probably shouldn't do. I'm admitting it to you. It's like my secret shame. But anyway, and there's so many people who have made themselves YouTubers by simply attacking Christians. And I don't want to be that person. But I think it's important in this case, and we finally did it today, where it actually said some names we normally don't, because we need to know what this looks like in our day and age. It's so important. And I think to that comment, it's so important to understand. Look, I traditionally thought that false teaching was bad because it moved us away from just exactly what the Lord wanted to say, which is partly true. But false teaching is so insidious because the people that are giving the false teaching. Because you'll swear up and down that they're a godly person, and in fact they're not. And then that's how they get in the demonic teaching, the teachings of demons, yeah. As Paul said in 1 Timothy. And so we do, unfortunately, have to look at the people themselves and how they're doing it, how they're saying it, what they're saying, and that's what these passages are for. That's what these passages are teaching us.
Yeah, like the Janus and Jambres, they look like they're doing the exact same thing that the godly people are doing, and it's actually not. And to Debbie's point, it's called cognitive dissonance. When you hear something that is so shocking to your brain, like, what? I've been listening to that person reading his Bible, loving his teaching my whole life. What do you mean? Like, your brain does not want to go down the path to undo everything that it thought, and so then it resists it. But what does scripture say? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so when that happens, that's opportunity to take it back to the word, take it back with the Holy Spirit, and say, is this you wanting to break my mind free of something that it's been under that it shouldn't? Or should I resist this? It's an opportunity to wrestle it out like a Berean with the Lord, right? Did we miss any comments?
Did you say a barista?
No.
But I don't think you're supposed to wrestle like a barista. So the moral of the story is don't name your children Janice or Jambres. If you name them Janice, just don't spell it J-A-N-N-E-S.
I would love to look up the actual Hebrew, breakdown of those names. I'll bet there's a powerful message in there.
We could call Jen Hatmaker. She probably did that.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. Sorry, guys. I majored in sarcasm in college. All right. So we're giving the gospel?
Yeah, let's do it. So somebody's listening. Now or later that is like, okay, well, this is the first time I'm hearing this stuff. I'm starting to believe Jesus is the Messiah. What do I do?
Yeah. So I'm going to do it in probably a vastly different way than Cher did, but it is what it is. There's a God. You cannot deny God. Everybody knows there's God. He's put it in our hearts. He's put it in nature. There is a God. God is holy. He's righteous. We are sinful. Period. We know we've sinned. It doesn't matter if we've done little sin or if we're a big sinner. We have sinned, period.
Yeah.
That sin in and of itself has separated us from a holy God. For all of eternity, it will separate us from a holy God. The opposite of being with a holy God for eternity is being in hell for an eternity. You don't have to like it. You don't have to agree with it. You don't have to understand it. But our sin separates us from God Almighty, the one true God, and will land us in eternity in hell, period. That's not the end of the story, though. God never wanted that. And the part that people like to say, Christianity, you're harsh and you're nasty, because no, you've missed the rest of the story. The story is that God never wanted that separation. He didn't want it then. He doesn't want it now. Amen. His heart breaks for that separation. He doesn't place you in hell. Your sin and your willingness to die in that sin places you in that separation. God has chased you for all eternity to end that separation, bring you back to himself. If you don't believe me, read the story that Jesus himself told about the prodigal son. The prodigal son is the most powerful story, not only for the story itself, but because Jesus Christ himself told it. And it's his way to tell you what God thinks of you. So God said, look, I punish sin, period. I'm a perfect God. I punish sin, but I don't want you to be the one that was punished for that sin. I'm going to send my son, Jesus Christ, my son who is a part of myself, to be a man, a real living, breathing, bleeding man to earth. He did that. Jesus came to earth in the most humble way possible. He lived a holy and perfect life. So in other words, his life, he was just like us in every single way, except that he never sinned. He was perfect. He became the only worthwhile sacrifice that God was willing to accept on behalf of our sin. In other words, he went before the court and said, Randy and Sherry, you've sinned, but I'm going to punish Jesus instead. Literally, that's what he did. Because he is the eternal judge. He is the great judge. He judges us for our sin. But instead of judging us and punishing us, he said, I'm casting all of your sin on Jesus Christ. The only way to do that, the only way, though, to be covered by Jesus' death and resurrection, Jesus then died a real, physical, legitimate death in every way, shape, or form, died. On the third day, God rose him up in a literal resurrection from the dead, a bodily and spirit resurrection from the dead. He destroyed, essentially, the power of death. We can have that exact same power, that identical life, restoration with God the Father, eternity in heaven with God the Father, if and only if we recognize that we've sinned, we recognize we need a Savior, we recognize that only Jesus Christ, no other way, not Jesus and, not Jesus or, only Jesus Christ saves us by his death and by his resurrection. And then we're baptized into Jesus. We baptize into the death, the sin that we were. We're risen up out of the water in the new life in Jesus Christ. At that time, Jesus gives us his spirit to empower us to live a holy and righteous life. Not to live a life that then forever says I'm good because I'm covered by grace, but that says now I live a righteous and a holy life because I have the power of Jesus Christ within me. I have the power of the Spirit. That's it. And guys, I will tell you that in my belief, the older I get, there isn't this, people aren't confused by, is there a God? There is no atheism. I don't believe that there's an atheism in any way, shape, or form. Why? Because he has put it in our hearts. All of humanity has been put in their hearts that there is an eternal God. There is a God, period. All of civilization, when you look back at ancient civilizations, if they didn't know who Adonai was, they knew there was a God. People deny God because they want to be their own God, period. The fact of the gospel is this. Christ has made a way for us, but it's only his way. There is no other way. People don't deny that there's a God. They deny they don't want to go the way of Jesus Christ, period.
Amen.
You know, I think it's such hogwash when people say, I understand intellectual confusion. I understand the enemy has pulled the blinds over people. But for most people, when they're honest with you, it's not that they don't believe that there's a God. It's not even that they don't believe they're a sinner. It's that they don't accept that the only way they have to go is through Jesus Christ. Especially in our Western culture. Look, it's my way, right? Why is the teaching of a Jen Hatmaker so insidious? Because it's find yourself first. It's go your way first. Jesus said the opposite. Give up your entire life and follow me.
Right.
The rich young man came to him. A rich young man, and Jesus said, he said, what must I do to enter eternal life? This is a real guy. This wasn't a parable. Mm-hmm. And Jesus said, you know the law. You've been raised as a Jew. You had to memorize the law. You know exactly what it is. Jesus wasn't being condescending. He was saying, you know the law. And by the way, before that, he said, why'd you call me a good teacher? Only one who is good. And in doing that, Jesus was establishing God. He wasn't saying that he wasn't God. He was saying God is the eternal judge. God is the only one who gets to judge. He then said, go. And Jesus knew what his answer was going to be. This was just part of the conversation. He said, you know the law. Go obey it. The guy said, I've obeyed the law. The guy was righteous. He followed the law. But he was going his own way. Jesus said, well, then go sell every single thing you have. Come follow me. And the guy, he couldn't do it. The guy said, no, I can't do it. I'm here to tell you, the overwhelming majority of people in America, especially those in the church, won't sell everything and go follow Jesus. They just won't. An hour on Sunday, and 2 hours on Sunday, an hour tending the garden at the church, an hour handing out soup cans at the church, that covers them in their minds. But that isn't what Jesus said. He said, go sell everything and follow me. And as I say it to you, it's the hardest thing for me to do because I don't want to sell everything. I don't want to. I got some stuff I like. But that's what he told me to do, right?
Right. But I mean, you're allowed to have a home.
Not literally. We talked about it earlier. This isn't literally. This is a God. It's Job. God, if I lose everything tomorrow, you're still sovereign Lord.
Amen.
God, if you gave me everything on earth, if you made me rich, it's still all yours. You're still a sovereign Lord. You are still my Lord, not my money.
And if you did ask me to literally sell it, it would be gone in a heartbeat.
And I'll be honest with you guys. Whatever in my faith, I've struggled with the fact that the Lord's going to take it all away. I grew up kind of poor. I grew up relatively poor. And money's always, security, not really money, but security has always been a struggle for me. And that part of scripture is such a deep struggle for me. I'll just be honest with you guys. But what the Lord has shown me is he, like Cher said, he wants to bless us, you guys. But our faith has to be in him, not in the world. That's all it is. And God's word overtly promises us that he's going to bless us. He clearly tells us that he's a generous God, a loving God, a kind God. He wants to give it all to us, you guys. But we first have to give it all to him.
Yeah. It is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. He wants to give us everything. But if our heart is with everything, then he can't give it to us because it's leading us astray. But man, that was anointed. That was amazing. Anointed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So good. And so if you're watching this today, and maybe you do consider yourself an atheist and you're like, well, he's totally off. I don't believe in God. I can guarantee something happened in your life to hurt you so badly, to cause so much trauma to your heart, that you decided at some point that there could not be a God because he wouldn't have done this. But yet your heart knew at one point there was. You made a decision to shut it down because of the pain and the anger. And I get that. And I would recommend watching The Shack, and I'm going to lose a whole bunch of people there because there's some heresy in The Shack. But it does paint the perfect picture of a father's heart who never wanted to hurt us.
And Cher's not advocating. Cher's not advocating the depiction of God in The Shack. There, she said it very clearly. There's some heresy in The Shack. So please don't say, well, then everything else Radiant Cherry said is garbage. It's not the case.
Yeah, it just depicts. I know people right. that their hearts have been healed by watching that movie. Hearts that were hardened against the Lord because they believed false theologies about him being this damning, judgmental, angry God that takes people away, that you know, takes our loved ones away, and you know, the lies of, oh, God just wanted to take that person. No, we live in a war. Satan is the one that comes to kill and steal and destroy, and God wants to give us life and life to the full, and that's what Jesus came for. And he is a good God. He is always good. And if in your life he's not been good, it's not that he hasn't been good. There's lies in there. It's the enemy turning us, flipping the understanding and making us think that God is not good. And so I know people whose heart, who were hardened against the Lord, who watched The Shack and for the first time understood, oh, God really does love. And so there is heresy in The Shack. Be careful with it. But if you are an atheist, understand God's heart is for you, and he's chasing you, and he loves you, and that's why he sent Jesus.
Yeah, I just don't want that to cloud the gospel message. I've never read, yeah. I'm an avid reader. I've never read The Shack. I've not watched The Shack. So that's, you know, it's for some people. It's not for some people. Understand, do it with extremely discerning eyes and only take the message that she's talking about, not their depiction of the Trinity. And it's not a mandate, you know?
No, it's not scripture. It's a fiction movie. It's a fiction movie, but there are people who it softens their heart to be able to start to receive Jesus, where before they've had a huge wall up because it's been too painful for them to even go down that path.
Amen.
So, but yeah, that was amazing. My husband is amazing. The Lord is amazing in you. Let's just look at the comments and say goodbye.
Let's pray.
Also sowing good seed, but it lands on different kinds of ground. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. All right. Yeah, we're good. My comments are stuck. So let's pray.
Okay. Father, I praise you for your sovereignty. I praise you for your presence. I praise you for just who you are, Father God. Lord, you know my heart. I have a tendency to want to give my opinion. And Lord, I pray forgiveness where that comes out, and that Lord, people, myself included, we would only hear your word. That Lord, you would be sovereign. You would be just the Lord of our hearts and minds and lives. That Lord, you would just make abundantly clear, like your word says, that the deeds of Janus and Jambres would cease, and they would become abundantly clear how evil they were. I pray, Lord, that that would become the case for all of the false teachers and teachings in our world. That Lord, we would just see so clearly, Lord, who is of you and who is not of you, and that we would follow only you, Father God. Amen. I praise you for your heart and your love and your grace, Lord Jesus. And Lord, I pray that ultimately in all things, you would be glorified in everything that we say and do. Bless those who've listened and participated, and just draw them close to your heart, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen and amen. That was fun.
Whoop,
that is good. That is good. And if anybody watches this and you're still like, well, I still don't understand how to be saved in Jesus, just message me and I'll get you in touch with Randy. All right. God bless you guys. Hi, Jamie. Good to see ya. That's Jamie in Pakistan.
Jamie in Pakistan. Wow.
You know?
That's awesome. All right. Let's hit it.
Okay. Bye, guys. God bless. Shabbat shalom.